nature of the Indian state, which is your core four paper and block four. In this unit, we are going to discuss basically three units, that is the role of the state in the Indian context. Next is about the development and welfare dimension, and third one is corrective dimension of Indian state. Basically, as we know, a person cannot stay without the society. As a person, as a human being, he must live within the society, within the state. And those who live without the society is either a god or a beast, as we know, defined by Aristotle. So he must live in the society. He must obey the rule and regulation of that society. He must obey the rules of the state. So the state varies from time to times, because the human beings or the individuals are ruled by alien rule, and they want a freedom. They want their own rights, so that they fight against the British rule and got independence and make their own constitution, and they make their self rule. And gradually the system of the state, the administrative system of the state, are changing from time to time. And it also developed different welfare dimension for its people, like the different five-year plans for the welfare of the people. Then we will discuss about the coercive dimension of state, in which we will discuss about the emergency situation proclaimed in India in different times. So without taking too much of time, we'll start the session. But before that, I request all the learners to please stay with us till the end, so that we'll take the question and answer session. And also, if possible, then we'll interact with our resource person. Thank you, sir. With this introductory word, I would like to invite today's our resource person, Dr. Gunanidhi Parikh, to start the session. Please, sir, take the session. Hello.
Good morning. Yes, am I audible?
Vijay? Yes, sir. Please continue, sir.
Hello, Vijay?
Yes, sir. Please continue. You are audible, sir.
Well, this is my second lecture. I have already taken lectures on University of Rights, and unfortunately, in between, our class has been cancelled for due to some technical problem. Today, I have been assigned a chapter called Changing Nature of Indian State, and actually, Changing Nature of Indian State. And in this blog, basically, what I'm going to do is, the sketch, what I'm going to do is basically, I will define what is state, then what is the difference between state and government, then what is regime, whether India will be called India will be called a nation state. Then we'll be discussing about the changing nature of Indian state. So what is Indian state? Whom we call Indian state? Then changing concept. It means that changing means it is a dynamic process. That's Togito Nuese Parivartito. How the Indian state has been evolved. It is a post-colonial Indian state. How the post-colonial state has been evolved and experience ups and downs in various phases, that I'll be discussing about. So what I'm going to do is that I'll be discussing about decades-wise, Nehruvian era, from 1947 to 67. Also, it is called Congress system, according to Rajini Kothari. Then I'll be moving towards 1970, the repressive state, emergency time, and Vijaya has beautifully explained why it is called repressive state, I'll be discussing about. Then I'll be moving toward 1980s, the 1980s, it is called techno. Managerial state, the Rajiv Gandhi era. Then I'll be discussing about what happened to Indian state after globalization. During the 1990s, what happened that there are three things emerged: Mandal, Kamandal, and Kumandal. Mandal matlab Mandal commissions. Kamandal matlab then the Rath Yatra has initiated by Advani. Then Kumandal globalizations. So how this phenomenon has impacted on Indian state, and how Indian state has been experiencing all these things, I'll be discussing about. Then at last, we'll be moving towards Modi regimes, Modi 2.0, and also what happened, what will be the world scenario, what will be the world order after post COVID-19, and what will be the how the Indian state will react post COVID-19's world order. So all these things I'll be discussing about in my lecture today. First, I'll be moving towards basically Nehruvian's era. Basically, the early phase of Indians in early phase of independence and 1947-1948 is basically, which is you can say that there are so much of riots, etc. Then partitions were there. There are so much riots. Even partition, there are partitions and riots happened, and about 20 million people actually they migrated from India to Pakistan, Pakistan and India. That happens. Then 1948 also happened. The riots things happened, and Gandhi has been assassinated. Mahatma Gandhi has been assassinated. Then 1948, another India-Pakistan war has happened. So in 1950, basically Indian state has adopted constitutions. So in early phase of Indian state, there are there are many problems actually India has experienced. And in 1950, we have adopted constitution. Sambidhan ko ame kono kala lagu kala. Aur sambidhan re beautifully it has experienced the nature of Indian state. Indian state ro kono Indian state kemti hoti eta bahut bhalo bhabe lekha aichi amo sambidhan re. Sambidhan ko ame jetele jiba prastavana ko jiba se prastavana lekha aichi with the people of India. With the people of India. So here peoples are powerful. They are sovereign. And Nehru was very much interested for a written constitution. At that time there are democracy which have unwritten constitutions also there. Basically the Britain. Britain has unwritten constitutions. But India Nehru was very much interested in written constitutions, and our constitution is another thing is that our constitution is not a product of revolutions. It is a product of deliberations. Debate constitutional assembly was created, and the idea of constitutional assembly was conceived by Mahatma Gandhi. And we have so much of debate, discussion, etc. in the constitutional assembly, and we have adopted the constitutions. So basically, in three sources derived our articles, basically objective resolutions, Government of India Act 1935, about 200 articles we have derived from there, and other constitutions. Okay, so objective resolutions 1946, there are two things I will try to read out. The constitutional assembly declares its firms solemnly resolves to proclaim India as a independent sovereign republic and draw upon her future governance from the constitutions. It means that independent sovereign republic is clearly mentioned, wherein all powers, authority of sovereign independent India, its constitution's part, and the government of India derived from the people. It is a popular sovereignty, peoples, it derived from the peoples. So we the people, actually it's actually defines our popular sovereignty. It is the will of the people that actually prevails. We have elections, and it is the will of the people that actually prevails. So basically, what I am doing is that state is an important concept. State is a very important concept in political science. And Gattel also tells that yes, political science begins and ends with the state. And also, state is an abstract concept. Government is actually it is the concrete concept. It is through government the state is actually functions. So Indian state is basically. Indian state is a set of institutions. For example, Indian when you refer to Indian state, it is basically a set of institutions. That set of institutions is basically it's executive, legislative, judiciary, police system, etc., military system, etc. All these institutions coming together and making up Indian state. So we are referring to Indian state means we are referring to these institutions. So the Indian state what I'm talking about today. Basically, the post-colonial Indian state. It is after the independence. Okay. So in preamble, we have the clear picture of the nature of Indian state. So with the people, popular sovereignty. Then preamble also saying that India is a sovereign state. What is a sovereign state? India is basically internally and externally independent. So internally it can take all the decisions. Also, externally, no other state can pressure on India. So India has externally independence without external interference. It takes decisions without external interference. So that is sovereign state. Then socialism. Actually, socialism, the word socialism has not been there in the original constitution, and it was inserted during 1976 of 42nd Amendment. Everybody knows about. And so then how the socialism actually reflected, and you can go to the directive principle state policy. There is there is welfare state, talking about welfare state, and the welfare state actually says about the socialism's kind of socialism's principle of Indian state. So then I'll be talking about secularism. So, secularism also a word which has not been there in the original constitutions, but it has inserted in 42nd Amendment during the time of Indira Gandhi, and he actually secularism is, there are two kinds of secularisms. I'll clear here. There are two kinds of secularisms. While Western secularism, then Eastern, there is Indian secularism. It means that we are actually adopting Indian secularisms according to Mahatma Gandhi's Samadharma Samabhava. Western secularism means that religions and politics, they are separate from each other. But Indian secularism saying that Samadharma Samabhava, it means that all religions are equal. आमे सब धर्म को समान हिसाब से देखिबा एही होची आम भारतीय धर्मनिरपेक्षता किंतु पाश्चात्य धर्मनिरपेक्षता होची कि सेमाने तांकर धर्मनिरपेक्षता अर्थ हैला सेमाने राजनीति ओ धार्मिक धर्म को सेमाने सेपरेट कर देखंती सेमाने धर्म को क्षेत्र पब्लिक पब्लिक लाइफ को आनंती नाही किंतु आम एथरे पब्लिक लाइफ रे भी आम धर्म को सेट बना जाय आ इट इट इज नॉट सेपरेटेड एक्चुअली we are at the state is actually the state is actually gives equals opportunity to all religions. It's actually sees or it sees equals all religions are equals in the eyes of the state, in the eyes of the Indian state. So republic, then another word is there, republic. So a state in which peoples are supreme, and there is no hereditary system. Our head of the state is actually elected by general elections, so it is there is elections and our head of the state actually elected. So there is no hereditary system at all. Like in Britain, what happened, there is hereditary system, the crowns is there coming from the hereditary, but here in the head of the state is not like Britain. Head of the state is there is hereditary, it is republic, so justice, social economy and political equality, fraternity is very important concept, the common brotherhood, bringing share bhatutva bhav. कारण डेमोक्रेसी जिते बेले आम कहूँ गोटे डेमोक्रेसी भातृत्व भाव बहुत इंपोर्टेंट रोल प्ले करो डेमोक्रेसी भातृत्व भाव ना से डेमोक्रेसी सृष्टि पारे ना तो भातृत्व भाव भी बहुत इंपोर्टेंट कनसेप्ट है आउ से भातृत्व भाव को आम आनीचु लिबर्टी इक्वालिटी एंड फ्रेटर्निटी थ्री थिंग्स वी हैव डेरिव्ड फ्रॉम फ्रेंच रेवोल्यूशन सेज द थ्री थिंग्स व्हाट द फ्रेंच रेवोल्यूशन सेज गिविंग द थ्री कनसेप्ट लिबर्टी इक्वालिटी एंड फ्रेटर्निटी. So then dignity of individuals, very important. Dignity of individuals has been written in our constitution's fundamental rights, Article 21, right to life. So DPSP, in DPSP also there is, certain things which have, ki satire modhe lekha hai je ki kemiti gute byakti ko kono ki tara kendi samman se boya rakhi parebo. That dignity can they say boya rakhi parebo. It is basically very related to human rights, So fundamental rights. There is also dignity of individuals. So this is welfare state. Indian state is a welfare state. What is welfare state? Actually, it has also there in the DPSP, the Active Principle of State Policy. Article 39 A and B, Article 39 B and C also clearly talks about the welfare state. And actually, what is welfare state? Welfare state actually basically a state which actually takes all the social policies, all of them, and gives basic amenity to its citizens. That is welfare state. Indian state is a welfare state. It has many welfare programs for its citizens. But there is also it is an asymmetrical federalism. Our federalism is asymmetrical federalism, and USA USA federalism is symmetrical federalism. Basically, what is asymmetrical? What is symmetrical? There is no equal status for all the states. There are certain states in India, there are certain states they get privilege. They get special status. But in USA, every state is equals. Okay. But here in for example, in Rajya Sabha also, there are states who has, you know, less seat, and there are states, you know, which has more seat for representations. So there is no equality in among the state or between the state in India. But in USA, there is equality. All states are equals. So that is a symmetrical federalism, but India's federalism is asymmetrical federalism. So that how you can, you know, differentiate between federalisms between India and USA. So Indian state is basically a sovereign state, socialist state, secular state, it is a republic state, and it is a welfare state, a democratic welfare state. So this is the nature of Indian state. Preamble has given a clear picture of Indian state. So then we'll be moving forward. In what happened to Indian state during the 1947 to 64 during the time of Nehruvian period. So in Nehruvian period, we are seeing that Indian state is it takes certain developmental measures, okay? Certain developmental welfare policy that taken, for example, key planning commissions. For example, there are land reform system, there are new revolutions. There are many also, there are actually building of certain dams, okay, for irrigations, multi-purpose irrigations. So all these things actually, they are in Nehruvian period. And we can say that in Nehruvian period, Indian state has acting as a developmental state. But Indian state is a soft state. According to Minerals, Gunnar Minerals, he's saying that Indian state is a soft state during that time. What is a soft state? It is because soft state, according to him, is that the state which does not use force to maintain the implementations of its social policies. Certain, for example, land reform system. Why the land reform system has been failed? Because he was saying it is because of the Indian state was soft state, and that's why the land reform system has been failed. I'll be talking about that things in a minute. Okay. So basically, planning commissions. So actually, when you are talking about developmental state, we must say that India is a socialist state, and it is centralized planning, plans. You know, it has a centralized planning commissions, okay, and it is a socialist state. And at that time, so in Nehru was also very much influenced by the socialist idea, and he was also very much interested in socialist idea, and also he observed how the USSR has, you know, progressed because of the socialist idea. So India has a planning commission and the centralized planning system. So, but planning commissions was not the idea. Planning commission concept not a post-colonial idea. It is idea that is actually a pre-independence idea, right? So during the time 1938, what happened in the Haripur Sessions Congress? At that time, the president of Congress was Subhash Chandra Bose, and he conceived the idea of planning commissions, and he also saying that there should be a planning committee for India, and the chairmanship was given to Jawaharlal Nehru. So from that we have experienced the planning commissions, but at that time the because of the World War II was happened, and the that planning commission was dissolved. So but what happened after India got independence? You also know about the Bombay plans 1944, and the Bombay plans, all the, you know, the capitalist people, certain group of capitalist people, they actually gathered together and drafted Bombay plans to set up a plans economy in the country. They actually, the idea is that they also thought that India needs the state, India needs the state, and there should be a planned economy. No doubt that the planned economy will actually hamper the business class for this. They still thinking that there should be a planned economy and there should be planning, and the state has a big role to play. From left to right, planning commission was obvious choice, and you know Nehru conceptions of new India was planned economy. And soon after the independence in 1958, the planning commission was established. And now the planning commission has been changed. The name has been changed. It actually becomes Niti Aayog in 2015. So we have 12 plans has already been finished, and we are actually progressing the 13th five-year plans. So we'll be I'll be discussing some gist of every plans means some important plans, and I'll be discussing about it. Okay, the first 5-year plans is basically Prathama 5-year Prathama Panchavarshika Yojana start hala 1956 madhyare basically agriculture sector ko beshi gurutwa diya gala. Agriculture sector was giving much more importance, and at that time Bhakra Nangal Yojana Hirakud dam was also built. The multi-purpose dams were also built. So 1956 to 61, there is actually the second 5-year plans actually gives importance to industry. Industrial sectors were giving very much importance. 1961 to 66, there are so much things happened in between 1961 to 66. What happened? 62, there was Indo-China war. 65, there are India-Pakistan war. There are drought also. So much things were happened. And in that time, there fertilizers plan established, state roads transport corporations were established, these things were established. But after that, there is a plan quality, 1966 to 69, because all these things had happened, the Indo-China war, Indo-Pakistan war, then what happened, the drought things had happened, that actually impact on the planning commission also. And we have actually planned for a we have actually planned for annual plans. That is,
hello. 1966. Hello. A small announcement, sir. Sorry for the interruption. Actually, I'm going to attend a web conference. Maybe I'm not attending at the end moment. That's why I request Dr. Antrayami Beria to moderate the session at the end. Dr. Antrayami Beria, sir.
Okay.
Please.
Is he there?
Yes, sir. He's online.
Okay, all right. I will take care of that. Please go ahead.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Please continue, sir. Yes, sir. Please continue.
The plan and the actually annual plans happened in 1966 to 67, 67 to 68, 68 to 69. So all this thing because of the war, then drought, etc., that actually impacted on the annual plans, and we have actually annual. There are annual plans. Okay, the 1969 to 74. During the time of Indira Gandhi, there are so much things happened. There is Garibi Hatao. Then the slogan Garibi Hatao was there, and then there is nationalization of 14th bank during that time. Green Revolution happened, and 1970 war was happened. Pokhran's test was happened. And these things, you know, during the post 5-year plans were there during the times of Indira Gandhi. Fifth 5-year plans actually basically giving importance to employment, poverty elevation, etc. And you know, then there is rolling plan. And how it happened after Indira Gandhi, after the Indira Gandhi government, there is another government's come in, that is Janata government. And during the Janata government, they rejected the 5-year plans that is actually initiated by its earlier incumbencies, and that is actually drafted by during the times of Indira Gandhi. So actually, what happened? It was rejected, and Janata government also what happened again when Indira Gandhi came into power, she also rejected what was drafted by Janata government. So what is that? The government, actually the government, Janata government actually ruled out the rigidity of 5-year plans. There's no rigidity at all. If somebody was there and adapted some 5-year plans, another government is coming and that government adapted another plans. So there is, you know, I will not be discussing all the things because all the plans all the five plants, you know, they are in your books. But there is 12 fire plants, and the 12 fire plants basically the planning commission has changed and it becomes ETRO, and we are actually in 13 fire plants, 2017 to 2022. So basically India is a socialist, India is a state controlled economy, and India is a socialist, and you know, Nehru was very much interested in socialist kind of economy and state controlled economy basically. And so and he also does not deny the roles of private sector. And that's why there is also we have both sectors, that is public sector and private sector. We have coexist together in India. Public and private sector coexist together in India, and both the sector coexist together, and no, that is called mishrita arthaniti. Among kon se etre besarkari anusthan bi achi, sarkari anusthan bi achi. To amo Bharat re kon achi mishrita arthaniti achi. Ao seti no kon ke amo this is state control economy, and you know ki it is also ki we are not moving towards market economy. During 1991, that things happened, but it is a plan economy, state control economy, and one kind of, you know, it is socialist economy was there in during the times of Nehru. So, and state has a big role to play. So, you know, then, you know, land reform. During the time of Nehru, there was a most important thing was second land reform system was there. And in the land reform system, what happened, he actually firstly abolitions of zamindari system, he abolished the zamindari system. Se kon kare zamindar pratha am kon thila ki sekre zamindar pratha thila bahut gude lokon ko pakare bahut gude jami thila a gude bahut gude lokon ko pakare jami nathila actually landless thila. To kon kare jete bele dekha gala ki jete public poverty allegations kai kon kara gala ki zamindari system pratha ko hote dewa pai prayas korthile Nehru. Ase kon kara gala ki ja pakare beshi jami nachi ସେ କ'ଣ ଯାହା ପାଖରେ ଜମି ନାହିଁ ତାକୁ ଦିଆ ହେଇଛି ସିଲିଂ ବ୍ୟବସ୍ଥା ସେଠୁ କରାଗଲା ଆଉ କେତେ କିଏ କେତେ ପରିମାଣରେ ଜମି ରଖିପାରିବେ ସେ ଚିନ୍ତା କରାଗଲା ସିଲିଂ ବ୍ୟବସ୍ଥା କିନ୍ତୁ କ'ଣ ହେଲା ସେ ବ୍ୟବସ୍ଥା ଫେଲ୍ ମାରିଥିଲା କାହିଁକି ନା ବହୁତ ଲୋକ କ'ଣ କଲେ ତାଙ୍କର ଯେଉଁ ଦେଶୀ ଯେଉଁ ଜମି ଥିଲା ତାକୁ ନିଜ କଜିନ୍ସ ନାଁରେ ନିଜ ରିଲେଟିଭ୍ସ ନାଁରେ କରିଥିଲେ ତ ଦ୍ୟାଟ୍ ଲ୍ୟାଣ୍ଡ ରିଫର୍ମ ସିଷ୍ଟମ୍ ହାଭ୍ ବିନ୍ ଫେସ୍ ଟୋଟାଲି ଆଣ୍ଡ ଦ୍ୟାଟ୍ସ ଗନର୍ ମିନେରାଲ୍ସ ଆକ୍ଚୁଆଲି ଟୋଲ୍ସ ଆବାଉଟ୍ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆ ଇଜ୍ ସବ୍ ଷ୍ଟେଟ୍ସ Actually, India is a soft state because it poor implementation of its socialist policies. Very poor implementation. It had a huge force, you know, during the times. There is food crisis, and I mean, some of the basically food crisis. Amar thila 1960s time re, samay re, sakhe dashakare amar kono thila khadya shastra bahut abhav thila. Amar kono thila. କି ଆମେ ସେଲ୍ଫ ରିଲାଏଣ୍ଟ ନଥିଲା ଇଣ୍ଡିଆ ୱାଜ୍ ନଟ୍ ସେଲ୍ଫ ରିଲାଏଣ୍ଟ ଆଉ ସେ କ'ଣ କରୁଥିଲା ସେ TL-480 ଆମେରିକା ଠାରୁ ସେ କ'ଣ ଆଣୁଥିଲା ସେ ଲୋନ୍ ଆଣୁଥିଲା ତ ସେଇ ତାକୁ ଦୂର କରିବା ପାଇଁ କ'ଣ କରାଗଲା କି ଦେର୍ ଇଜ୍ ଗ୍ରୀନ୍ ରିଭଲ୍ୟୁସନ୍ସ କି ହେଲା ଖାଦ୍ୟ ଶସ୍ତ୍ରର ଅଭାବକୁ ଦୂର କରିବା ପାଇଁ ଆଉ ସେଲ୍ଫ ରିଲାଏଣ୍ଟ ରହିବା ପାଇଁ ଗ୍ରୀନ୍ ରିଭଲ୍ୟୁସନ୍ସ ହେଲା ଆଉ ସେ ଆକ୍ଚୁଆଲି ବେସିକାଲି ଗ୍ରୀନ୍ ରିଭଲ୍ୟୁସନ୍ ହେଲା ସେକେଣ୍ଡ ଇନ୍ ଏଗ୍ରିକଲଚର୍ ସେକ୍ଟର୍ ଆଉ ସେ ଫୁଡ୍ କ୍ରାଇସିସ୍ ଆକ୍ଚୁଆଲି ଗ୍ରୀନ୍ ରିଭଲ୍ୟୁସନ୍ କରାଗଲା ବେଶୀ ଗ୍ରୀନ୍ ରିଭଲ୍ୟୁସନ୍ ଯେଉଁ ହେଲା ଆମେ ହାଇବ୍ରିଡ୍ ସିଡ୍ ଆମେ ୟୁଜ୍ କରାଗଲା ଫର୍ଟିଲାଇଜର୍ସ ରାସାୟନିକ ସାରର ବ୍ୟବହାର କରାଗଲା ବହୁତ ଗୁଡ଼ିଏ ରାସାୟନିକ ସାର ବ୍ୟବହାର କରାଗଲା ଆଉ କ'ଣ କରାଗଲା ହାଇବ୍ରିଡ୍ ସିଡ୍ର ବ୍ୟବହାର କରାଗଲା ପ୍ରଡକ୍ସନ୍ ପାଇଁ ଆଉ ସେ ବେସିକ୍ଲି ଗ୍ରୀନ୍ ରିଭଲ୍ୟୁସନ୍ କ'ଣ କରାଗଲା 14 ଡିଷ୍ଟ୍ରିକ୍ଟରେ ପ୍ରଥମ କରି ଷ୍ଟାର୍ଟ ହୋଇଥିଲା ଆଉ ସେ ବେସିକ୍ଲି କ'ଣ କରାଗଲା କି ଯେଉଁ ଜାଗାରେ ଇରିଗେସନ୍ ଫାସିଲିଟି ବେଶୀ ଅଛି ସେ ଜାଗାରେ କରାଗଲା ବେସିକରି ତାକୁ ପ୍ରଥମ କରିଛି ଏକ୍ସପେରିମେଣ୍ଟ କରାଗଲା ଯଦି ହରିୟାନା ପଞ୍ଜାବ ତ ଦେଢ଼ ରିଜନାଲ୍ ଡିସ୍ପ୍ୟୁରିଟି ବିକଜ ଯେତେବେଳେ ଗୋଟେ କିଛି ଅଞ୍ଚଳ ଉନ୍ନତି କରିଯିବେ ଅନ୍ୟ ଅଞ୍ଚଳମାନେ ଉନ୍ନତି କରିବେ ନାହିଁ କାରଣ ଯେତେବେଳେ ଗ୍ରୀନ୍ ରିଭଲ୍ୟୁସନ୍ ସେଟର୍ ହେଲା ସେ ଅଞ୍ଚଳ ଉନ୍ନତି କରିଗଲା ଅନ୍ୟର ଉନ୍ନତି କରିପାରିଲେ ନାହିଁ ନିଶ୍ଚିତ ଭାବେ ରିଜନାଲ୍ ଡିସ୍ପ୍ୟୁରିଟି ତ ଏସବୁ ଜିନିଷ ହେଲା ଆଉ କ'ଣ ହେଲା ତାପରେ ଆମେ ଦେଖାଗଲା କି ଯେଉଁ ଆକ୍ଚୁଆଲି ଗ୍ରୀନ୍ ରିଭଲ୍ୟୁସନ୍ ହୁ ହାଜ୍ ଗେଟ୍ ଗଟ୍ ଦ ବେନିଫିଟ୍ ଅନ୍ ଗ୍ରୀନ୍ ରିଭଲ୍ୟୁସନ୍ ବେସିକାଲି ଇଟ୍ ଦ rich farmers, actually rich farmers and basically those who have jan khoni shaniya jo kushakama thile sako eta bishesh hala jan gariba shaniya jan mane small and marginal farmers they actually not got benefit over it because ki jan mane ଫର ଏକ୍ସାମ୍ପଲ୍ ଯେତେବେଳେ କୃଷି କାମ ହେଉଛି ତାହେଲେ ସେମାନେ ରାସାୟନିକ ସାରର ବ୍ୟବହାର ହେଉଛି, ରାସାୟନିକ ସାର ପାଇଁ ସେମାନେ କ'ଣ କଲେ ଲୋନ୍ ଆଣିବାକୁ ପଡ଼ିବ। ତ ବେସିକାଲି ଦେଖାଗଲା କି ଯେଉଁମାନେ ଗରିବ ଶ୍ରେଣୀର ଲୋକମାନେ ଯେଉଁମାନେ କ'ଣ କଲେ ଯେଉଁ ଲୋନ୍ ଆଣିଲେ ଆଉ ସେମାନେ କ'ଣ କଲେ କି ସେମାନେ ତାଙ୍କର ଜମିରେ ସେମାନେ ମାନେ ତାଙ୍କ ସାର ପ୍ରୟୋଗ କରିଲେ, କିନ୍ତୁ କ'ଣ ହେଲା କି ଲୋନ୍କୁ ରିପ୍ଲେ ନାଇଁ କରିପାରେ। ବହୁତ ଗୁଡ଼ିଏ ଆମେ ଦେଖାଗଲା କି ବହୁତ ଗୁଡ଼ିଏ ଫାର୍ମର୍ ସୁଇସାଇଡ୍ କରିଦେଉଛି, ବହୁତ ଗୁଡ଼ିଏ କେସେସ୍ ମାନେ ହେଉଛି ଏବେ ବି ଫାର୍ମର୍ ସୁଇସାଇଡ୍ କେସ। ତ ବହୁତ ଗୁଡ଼ିଏ ପ୍ରୋବ୍ଲେମ୍ ଅଛି, ରେଗୁଲେସନ୍ସ ବି ବହୁତ ଗୁଡ଼ିଏ ପ୍ରୋବ୍ଲେମ୍ ହେଇଛି, ଆଣ୍ଡ ଇଟ୍ ଆକ୍ଚୁଆଲି ବେସିକାଲି ଇନ୍ଫ୍ଲେଟ୍ ଟୁ ଦ ରିଚ୍ କ୍ଲାସ୍ ଅଫ୍ ଫାର୍ମର୍ସ, ନଟ୍ ଦ ପୁଅର୍ କ୍ଲାସ୍ ଫାର୍ମର୍ସ। ସୋ ଦିସ୍ ଇଜ୍ ହାଉ ଦ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆନ୍ ଷ୍ଟେଟ୍ ବିହେଭ୍ ଡ୍ୟୁରିଂ ଦ ଟାଇମ୍ସ ଅଫ୍ ନେହେରୁ। ଇଟ୍ ଆକ୍ଚୁଆଲି ଡ୍ୟୁରିଂ ଦ ଟାଇମ୍ ଅଫ୍ ନେହେରୁ ଇଟ୍ ଇଜ୍ ବେସିକାଲି ବିକମ୍ସ ଇନ୍ ଡେଭଲପମେଣ୍ଟ ଷ୍ଟେଟ୍, ଡେଭଲପମେଣ୍ଟାଲ୍ ଷ୍ଟେଟ୍, ଦ ଫାଇଭ୍ ଇୟର୍ସ ପ୍ଲାନ୍ସ ଦେନ୍ ମେନି ସୋସିଆଲିଷ୍ଟ ପ୍ରୋଗ୍ରାମ୍ସ ଆର୍ ଦେୟାର୍, ୟୁ ନୋ। ସୋ ଇଟ୍ ଇଜ୍ ଇଟ୍ସ ଡେଭଲପମେଣ୍ଟାଲ୍ ଷ୍ଟେଟ୍, ଅଲ୍ସୋ ଇଟ୍ ଇଜ୍ ସଫ୍ଟ ଷ୍ଟେଟ୍ ବିକଜ୍ ଇଟ୍ ହ୍ୟାଜ୍ ଫେଲ୍ ଟୁ ଇମ୍ପ୍ଲିମେଣ୍ଟ ଇଟ୍ସ ଲ୍ୟାଣ୍ଡ ରିଫର୍ମ ସିଷ୍ଟମ୍ସ, ଓକେ। ଦେନ୍ ଡ୍ୟୁରିଂ 1970s ହ୍ୱାଟ୍ ହ୍ୟାପନ୍ ଇନ୍ ହ୍ୱାଟ୍ ଟୁ ହ୍ୱାଟ୍ ହ୍ୟାପନ୍ ଟୁ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆନ୍ ଷ୍ଟେଟ୍, ଇଟ୍ ବିକମ୍ସ ଏ କୋଏର୍ସିଭ୍ ଷ୍ଟେଟ୍, ଆଣ୍ଡ ଆଇ ଆମ୍ ରେଫରିଂ ଟୁ ବେସିକାଲି ଏମର୍ଜେନ୍ସି ଟାଇମ୍, ଡ୍ୟୁରିଂ ଦ ଏମର୍ଜେନ୍ସି ଟାଇମ୍ ହ୍ୱାଟ୍ ହ୍ୟାପନ୍ ଇନ୍ଦିରା ଗାନ୍ଧୀ ପ୍ରୋକ୍ଲେମ୍ ଏମର୍ଜେନ୍ସି ଡ୍ୟୁରିଂ 1975। ଆଣ୍ଡ ଇନ୍ 1975 ଇନ୍ଦିରା ଗାନ୍ଧୀ ପ୍ରୋକ୍ଲେମ୍ ଏମର୍ଜେନ୍ସି, ଆଣ୍ଡ ହ୍ୱାଟ୍ ହ୍ୟାପନ୍ ଇନ୍ଦିରା ଗାନ୍ଧୀ ଗଟ୍ ୟୁ ନୋ ହି ଓନ୍ ଦ ଇଲେକ୍ସନ୍, ହି ଓନ୍ ଦ ଇଲେକ୍ସନ୍ ଆଣ୍ଡ ୟୁ ନୋ ଗିଭିଂ ଦ ସ୍ଲୋଗାନ୍ ସହ ଗରିବୀ ହଟାଓ। ବଟ୍ ଆହ୍ଲାବାଦ ହାଇକୋର୍ଟ ଆକ୍ଚୁଆଲି ହ୍ୱାଟ୍ ହ୍ୟାପନ୍, ଆହ୍ଲାବାଦ ହାଇକୋର୍ଟ ଆକ୍ଚୁଆଲି ରିଜେକ୍ଟେଡ୍ ଇଟ୍, ରିଜେକ୍ଟେଡ୍ ଇଟ୍ ଆଣ୍ଡ ଗିଭ୍ସ ଏ ଫାର୍ଡିକ୍ଟ ଦାଟ୍ ଇନ୍ଦିରା ଗାନ୍ଧୀ ହାଜ୍ ୟୁଜ୍ ଇଲିଗାଲ୍ ମିସିନେରୀ ଟୁ ୱିନ୍ ଦ ଇଲେକ୍ସନ୍। ସୋ ଦିସ୍ ଇଜ୍ ହାଉ ୟୁ ନୋ ଦେର୍ ଇଜ୍ ଅଲ୍ସୋ ଦେର୍ ଇଜ୍ ପ୍ରୋଟେଷ୍ଟ ଏକ୍ସେଟ୍ରା ଏକ୍ସେଟ୍ରା, ଦେନ୍ ଜେପି ମୁଭମେଣ୍ଟ ୱାଜ୍ ଷ୍ଟାର୍ଟେଡ୍, ଟୋଟାଲ୍ ରିଭଲ୍ୟୁସନ୍ ଜେପି ମୁଭମେଣ୍ଟ ୱାଜ୍ ଷ୍ଟାର୍ଟେଡ୍। So all those things actually, and what happened during the times there was, so what happened, Indira Gandhi proclaimed emergency, the personal liberty was curtailed, ବ୍ୟକ୍ତିଗତ ସ୍ୱାଧୀନତା କ'ଣ କରାଲା କ'ଣ ଛିନ୍ନ ଛିନ୍ନ ହେଲା, ସେଥିରେ ବ୍ୟକ୍ତିଗତ ସ୍ୱାଧୀନତାକୁ ସୋ ସିଭିଲ ଲିବର୍ଟିଜ୍ ଦେନ୍ ଇନକ୍ଲୁଡିଂ ହେଭିଅର୍ ସ୍କୋପ୍ ଅଫ୍ ସସ୍ପେଣ୍ଡ, ଦେନ୍ ଦେର୍ ଇଜ୍ ନୋ ଫ୍ରିଡମ୍ ଅଫ୍ ସ୍ପିଚ୍, ନୋ ଅପୋଜିସନ୍, ଦେନ୍ ଥାଉଜେଣ୍ଡ ଓପୋନେଣ୍ଟ ୱାର୍ ଜେଲ୍ଡ। ଓକେ, ସୋ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆ ଷ୍ଟେଟ୍ ବିହେଭ୍ ଲାଇକ୍ ଅଥରିଟେରିଆନ୍ ଆଣ୍ଡ କୋଏର୍ସିଭ୍ ଫର୍ମସ୍। ଆଣ୍ଡ ଅତୁଲ କୋହଲି ୱାଜ୍ ସେଇଙ୍ଗ କି ଇଣ୍ଡିଆ, ଅତୁଲ କୋହଲି ଇନ୍ ହିଜ୍ ବୁକ୍ସ ଆକ୍ଚୁଆଲି ସେଇଙ୍ଗ କି ଇନ୍ ହିଜ୍ ଆର୍ଟିକଲ୍ ଇଣ୍ଟରପ୍ରିଟିଂ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆ ଡେମୋକ୍ରାସି ଷ୍ଟେଟ୍ ସୋସାଇଟି ଫ୍ରେମୱାର୍କ, ହିଜ୍ ସେଇଙ୍ଗ କି ଦ ସିଗ୍ନିଫିକାନ୍ସ ଅଫ୍ ପଲିଟିକାଲ୍ ପାର୍ଟି ହେଜ୍ ଡିକ୍ଲାର୍ ଦ ପଲିଟିକାଲ୍, ଦେର୍ ଇଜ୍ ନୋ ପଲିଟିକାଲ୍ ପାର୍ଟି ଏଟ୍ ଦ୍ୟାଟ୍ ଟାଇମ୍, ଆଣ୍ଡ ପର୍ସନାଲ୍ ଦେର୍ ଇଜ୍ ପର୍ସନାଲ୍ ରୁଲ୍ସ କମ୍ ଟୁ ଦ ରିପ୍ଲେସ୍ ଅଫ୍ ପାର୍ଟି ରୁଲ୍ସ, ଦେର୍ ଇଜ୍ ପର୍ସନାଲ୍ ରୁଲ୍ସ ଆଣ୍ଡ ପର୍ସନାଲ୍ କମାଣ୍ଡ, ଇଟ୍ ଇଜ୍ ଦ ଇନ୍ଦିରା ଗାନ୍ଧୀ ହୁ ୱିଲ୍ ଡିସାଇଡ୍ ଏଭ୍ରିଥିଙ୍ଗ୍ସ, ନୋ। ଆଣ୍ଡ ଦ ପବ୍ଲିକ୍ ବ୍ୟୁରୋକ୍ରେସି ଆର୍ ଅଣ୍ଡର ପ୍ରେସର୍ ଆଟ୍ ଅଲ୍ସ, ଆଣ୍ଡ ଦେର୍ ଇଜ୍ ପବ୍ଲିକ୍ ବ୍ୟୁରୋକ୍ରେସି ଦେ ଆକ୍ଚୁଆଲି ୱାର୍କିଂ ଅଣ୍ଡର ଦ କମାଣ୍ଡ୍ସ ଅଫ୍ ଇନ୍ଦିରା ଗାନ୍ଧୀ, ଆଣ୍ଡ ଇଟ୍ ଇଜ୍ ଅଲ୍ସୋ ସେଇଙ୍ଗ ଦ୍ୟାଟ୍ ଦେର୍ ଇଜ୍ କମିଟେଡ୍ ଜିନିଷ, ଜୁଡ଼ିସିଆରି ସିଷ୍ଟମ୍ ଅଲ୍ସୋ ୱାର୍କିଂ ଅଣ୍ଡର ଡାଇରେକ୍ସନ୍ସ ଅଫ୍ ଇନ୍ଦିରା ଗାନ୍ଧୀ। So there is nothing called neutrality in public bureaucracy, and civil service becomes more and more politicized, whereas there are civil disorder, violence, corruption, crime, everything are come to be associated with political life. So there are so much of corruption, there are so much of violence happening during that time. So at that time, Indian democracy has been challenged and actually darkened in entering into very dark periods. No, and everybody talking about how Indian democracy will be able to sustain in the future. And even Atul Kohli also very much suspicious about whether Indian democracy will be exist or not. No, but India democracy has been exist. And you know, still it is working. So Indira Gandhi during that time Indian state becomes a coercive state. What is a coercive state? Coercive state is one which actually use force, which actually use its police system, which actually use its force machinery to maintain law and order. That's a coercive state. that is a cohesive state, and in that, during that time, the Indian state becomes a cohesive state and authoritarian state. And there is no democracy at all at that time. So, then we'll be moving towards Rajiv during the times of 1980. During the times of 1980, there are so much things happened, and you know, Rajiv Gandhi, during the time of Rajiv Gandhi, there are, you know, the Indian state becomes a techno-managerial state, and you know, techno-managerial state, and India, basically at that time, Rajiv Gandhi, it becomes Silicon State actually. You know, and so much, you know, science, and there is so much development of science and technology, etc. And it is actually becomes Silicon State. Then the space of Sahavanu and the opens of MOOCs was very, you know, different kind of picture to Indian state. And Rajiv Gandhi was playing a soft Hindutva politics during that time. You know, while opening to MOOCs, etc. Also, he was also very much interested to extremist group of Muslims, basically. While actually Sahavanu happened, it is because of the support of some extremist Muslim groups, he actually opposed Sahavanu case, you know. And see, then, you know, so at the time, Indian state was very much Silicon State. So what happened during that 1980s period to, you know, what happened to Indians, politics has also changed from one party dominance, Congress system during the times of 1947 to 1967, Congress system, and there is one party system, one party dominance. Then there is a dominance during the 1970s, Janata government actually challenged the, you know, Congress system. Also, there is in 1980s, 1990s, there are coalition politics becomes very important, very prominent, and the federals, and then the federalism becomes very much, you know, cooperative kind of federalism, and the state becomes very important at that time. The centralized things that were challenged by some state, the federal system becomes more and more cooperative at that time. So during 1980s, what happened, and other things, three things happened in the 1990s era. Mandal commissions, then there is Commandal, then is Bhumandal. Three things that actually will define the nature of Indian state. Mandal commission was there, the OBC reservations, and because of the OBC reservations, that's one more thing happened. And to actually challenge the things, Advani actually initiated Rath Yatra, that is Commandal, can say that. And there is Bhumandal also, globalization. So in globalization, what happened to Indian state, we'll be discussing. During that time, you know, globalization, where India was a very close, before globalization, India was a very closed system, closed economic system. Closed economy. And what happened during the times, 1990s, India had some unprecedented economic growth, and there are so much of balance of payment crisis at that time, and India approached to World Bank and IMF. And World Bank and IMF, they actually gave loans to India, and they gave certain conditionality, a structural adjustment program, that is. Then the conditionality is that they should liberalize the market, etc. India enter into the phase of liberal economy. So from planned economy, central economy, to planned economy, socialist economy, we are moving towards the liberal economy, and that is new liberal economy, that is that during the times of P.V. Narasimha Rao was the prime minister, and at the time finance minister was Manmohan Singh. So we are moving to new liberal economy. And in the new liberal economy, what happened? Indians there is LPG, liberalization, privatization, and globalization. So we liberals our economy. We privatize many things, and because of the privatization, what happened? The rich and poor, the gap between rich and poor has widened. Okay. So the rich and poor, the gap between rich and poor has been widened during that time. And you know, so Globalization is basically, if I am saying, globalization is basically integration of economy, capital, technology, ideas. Yeah, it has globalization to matlab hoti ki amar ideas to economy ko sab integrate, sanjogi karan, ekatri karan kari bata. Am national economy ko amar kato ba, jeo antarani ko arthanti sota amar sanjogi karan kari ba. Okay. So everything is like for flows of ideas, technology, because of technical advancement, the social media, etc., etc., the globalization becomes more prominent. Okay. So actually you are, for example, COVID-19 jo hala, actually it is originated in China. China oriented hala, kintu ame jete bele globalization ra ache, China oriented hala moddhyo, ama samastanku seta spread kala. Because people are moving from one country to another country. গোটে দেশর আগে কিছু বোঝাচ্ছেন পিপলস মানে, তো পিপলস মানে মুভিং করছেন, আইডিয়াস মুভিং করছি, তো সেই সেটা হচ্ছে গ্লোবালাইজেশন। গ্লোবাল ইয়ার একচুয়ালি সেই গ্লোবাল ফেজ, গ্লোবাল ফেজ বিকজ ইট ইজ স্ট্যান্ডার্ড, গ্লোবালাইজেশন বিকম স্ট্যান্ডার্ড বিকজ অফ দ্য অ্যাডভান্সমেন্টস অ্যাডভান্সমেন্টস অফ আইটি, ইনফরমেশন টেকনোলজি অ্যান্ড ইউ নো। সো ইন্ডিয়ান সোশ্যালিস্ট প্যাটার্ন অফ সোসাইটি and centralized things actually exchange. So what happened to national sovereignty? So ame basically dekhiba ki jo national sovereignty kotha chinta kara sabule kon hoy ki relations kotha kara global governance kotha kara united dikhoy united nations IMF etc our sovereignty has been lost. Other Indian sovereignty has been lost. So other nation state other national state has been lost because of this sovereignty has been lost. Some sovereignty has been eroded. Some argue that yes, sovereignty has been eroded. Yes, in certain sections, for example, when India went to World Bank and IMF for its loans, at that time when India went to IMF and World Bank for its loans, that gives certain conditionalities and these loans were certain with certain conditionalities. So amko si conditionalities to amko kon koriba koribo ta ko fulfill koriba ko koribo. So sei samoy re nishu bhare am kahiba ki am sovereignty lost because at that time, for example, during the times of COVID-19, the global governance has failed. Global governance has failed. WHO, it's actually in my view, WHO has been failed. So what happened? We are actually the people are looking for their state. For example, they are not looking for some market. They are not looking for the private actors. Where the private actors that comes? It is the state who actually playing a very important role for securing its own citizens. So nation state is not that. Nation state alive during the times of COVID-19. And what happened to India? After that, so it will be very very interesting to see what happened to India after COVID-19, because the world order will be changed. Okay, so we will be actually it is very very interesting. Amko dekhibaku padibo ki India ro nature ta kemiti change hobo after COVID-19. So I'll be discussing about three things, various three perspectives here. Legal perspective, while I'm discussing about the new legal kind of economy, we actually discuss about the legal perspective. But Gandhian perspective, Gandhian perspective of Indian state, Gandhian perspective on the Gandhi completely, you see, don't believe the concept of state. Concept of state would be a soulless machine, that is Atman. He is very much critical about modern civilization. Tandor Bohijan Ochi, Hindu Hind Swaraj, Jati. 1909 କଣ ହେଇଥିଲା 1909 ପ୍ରକାଶିତ ହେଇଥିଲା ସେଥିରେ ସେ କଣ କହିଥିଲେ କି ଲେଖିଥିଲେ କି ହି ୱାଜ୍ ଭେରି ମଚ୍ କ୍ରିଟିକାଲ୍ ଆବାଉଟ୍ ମଡର୍ନ ସିଭିଲାଇଜେସନ୍ ସହିତ ସେ ବହୁତ ସେ ମଡର୍ନ ସିଭିଲାଇଜେସନ୍ କ୍ରିଟିସାଇଜ୍ କରୁଛନ୍ତି ବିକଜ୍ ଇଟ୍ ଆକ୍ଚୁଆଲି ଲିଡ୍ସ ୱାର୍ଡ ସେଲ୍ଫ ସେଣ୍ଟର୍ ଆମକୁ ସେଲ୍ଫ ସେଣ୍ଟର୍କୁ ନେଇଯାଉଛି ଆମର ସଲ୍କୁ ନେଗ୍ଲେକ୍ଟ କରୁଛି ସେଥିପାଇଁ ସେ କ'ଣ କହୁଥିଲେ କି ସେ ହି ୱାଜ୍ ଭେରି ମଚ୍ କ୍ରିଟିକାଲ୍ ଆବାଉଟ୍ ଆଣ୍ଡ ହି ୱାଜ୍ ଭେରି ମଚ୍ interested in decentralization of power. Se chahutle ki amar vikendrikaran ho amar samata vikendrikaran se chahutle ki that should be gram swaraj kotha kohutle and say maybe say चाहूँगी कि gas should be the quality should be called small. Small is beautiful. हमें देखिए दरकार सेटिंग आने रहो. हमें देखिए सेटिंग से बुरे आइडिया दिखले कि trusted पूरा कथा से आइडिया दिखले. तर अर्थ है कि आम जी दरकार जी आम संपत्ति दरकार से आम रहा बाकी संपत्ति आम तार ट्रस्टी हिसाब से रही तो सी सर्वोदय कथ कहते समस्त हृदय हो तर इकोनोमी थी सर्वोदय कटेल इंडस्ट्री कथ कहते से मानने शिल्प कुटीर इंडस्ट्री कथ को सी कहते कि इंडस्ट्रियलाइजेस कथ को सी विरोध करते शिल्प कुटीर को सी से ब्रिज इकोनोमी को सी बहुत प्राधान्य देते सो दैट इज द पर्सपेक्टिव इंडिया इन गांधीन पर्सपेक्टिव इंडिया सुड बी लाइक दिस से कहते गाँव को फेरी चाहिए तो से ग्राम स्वराज कला बेल गाँव को गोटे से रिपब्लिक हिसाब से देखुते गाँव को फेरी चल बोली से कहते ग्राम ग्राम पंचायत को बेसी से डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन पावर कथ कहते से चाहूँ कि कमी गाँव को बेसी क्षमता दिए लोक बेसी क्षमता दिए डिसेंट्रलाइज कर पावर को सेन्ट्रलाइज नक लोक निकट को पावर को अणा जाए से भेज स्वराज कथ भी कह ग्राम स्वराज तो then Marxist perspective of Indian state, they actually talking about the Indian state is a instruments of capitalist people. The capitalist people's instruments of capitalist people. And basically India does not have one ruling class, India has different ruling class. Sudipto Kabiraj, then Hamza Alvi, all are saying about the Indian state is a instruments of capitalist people and it is not working for the benefit of the poor. And Sudipto Kabiraj, he is talking about he, there are three dominant ruling classes there, foreign bourgeoisie, indigenous bourgeoisie, and federal, feudal class. All these ruling classes, they actually combined together, and they actually, this elite class, they ruled, actually. And Indian state actually behaving according to this ruling class. So Sudipto Kabiraj and Hamza Alvi, they are talking about, they are Marxist, and they're talking about the Indian, their Indian perspective. They're talking about the Marxist perspective in the Indian state. Okay. Then there is post-colonial Indian state. Post-colonial Indian state is basically talking about that how Indian state has the continuity, the value, the culture that is actually, that actually experienced by Indian state during the time of Britishers that still exists still today. For example, the English culture. For example, the IS, the civil service. This system was created by Britishers. For example, the court system, which created Britishers created this system, and we still we are continuing these things. For example, the court system for IPC, Indian Penal Code, Criminal Procedure Code, all these things actually created by the Britishers, and we are still continuing this. So Indians say they, for example, the Partha Chatterjee, then Dipesh Chakraborty, all these actually they are then you know. this they are talking about the post colonial Indian state. How the colonial state still continuing the experience, the value system of the of their colonial master. They are not free from their colonial master. Still there are certain value system, still there are certain culture they experiencing still today. That is the post colonial Indian state. So all these things we are covering. And now what I'll do is that I'll stop here. Then we'll have some second questions. Okay. So I'll encourage the students to ask.
Hello.
Okay.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes. So so thank you, Dr. Gunanadi Barik sir. The way you touch upon all the part of changing nature of Indian state start from the formations of constitution and you have developed the idea of Nehruvian concept of Indian states from secularism to socialism to different other political format, different other political process to develop India as a state and their changing nature in the contemporary period. So you basically try to focus on the phases, on the different phases of India over the period of time, the revolutions of India have a different phase to carry forward, right? And on that context, there are different aspects, there are different concepts, there are different things India has to change over the period of time. And you have touched upon all the parts so beautifully, and thank you so much. So now I would request all the learners, if they have any questions, they can directly mute their mic and ask a question, or they can drop their question in the chat box. So if anybody have any question, please ask directly to the research person. Unmute your mic and ask question. Anybody? Ganesh Chandra Das, Madhusmita Mahapatra, if you are listening, you can ask. You can directly ask the question. Hello? Hello? Ganesh Chandra Das, do you have any questions to ask? Nitish Kumar Panda?
No, sir.
Okay, Madhusmita Naik?
Okay.
Hold on,
sir.
Madhusmita Naik? Okay, no, sir. Nitish Kumar Panda, any question? Nitish Kumar Panda?
No, sir.
All right.
Hi.
All right, so the students, I think they got the information, they got everything so well, because you described this in a manner to just easy to understand the concept of the nature of Indian states. So now, like, I can wind up, or I can conclude my session, and I would rather say to stay for long. I would thank you, Dr. Gunanidhi Barik, for your kind support and kind presence, and your presentation on the topic of Indian nature and states. And we'll be in touch soon, and we'll be provide or arrange more class for you on different other topic. And I would also like to thank our technical person, Rudra Pratap Das, for this technical support to me, to research person, and to hold and communicate to the students of different part of Odisha. Not but the least, I would thank Vijay Behara to hand over this session to me, to conduct and to conclude the session. So on this note, I would thank Dr. Gunanidhi Behara for his time and for his intellect thought and for his intellect idea. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, Antar.
Okay. Let's close the session now. Rudra Pratap Das.
Yes, sir. Do you have any questions? Please ask me.
Okay, we can discuss it later on, because I have some work to do, because there is lots of work in the office. So we can discuss it later. Is that fine, sir? Okay, I really wanted to ask, or really wanted to interact with you, but now this is the exam time, and we are all busy with our respective work. Okay, hello.